Beloved, we celebrate the goodness of God. He's been teaching us of his ways, and we are learning to root out Satan in our lives. Our spirit man is perfected. It is sealed unto the day of redemption. Our problem is soulish. That's where all the attacks and the warfare is, the jealousies, the anger, the bitterness, all of us. We're trying to save our souls by the word of God. So we must take the word of God and relate it to the practical affairs of life. All these things I talk about are things I've discovered in the pastorate to free us from jealousies. Somebody gets a raise, rejoice with them. You're making 35, and some, like one of my ministers, get a bonus for $100,000. How many people even make $100,000 a year in the church? Well, we rejoice with him. That's the way the kingdom goes, and then God will start blessing us. Somebody getting a $100,000 bonus is an indication to you that your heavenly Father can bless at that level. Several years ago, this guy was given a testimony that he flies his citation jet solely from the interest rate payments on his savings account. He has that much money. And at that time, a citation with two pilots, insurance, gas, and travel was about $550,000 a year. And he said he does that from interest payments from his savings account so that it was effortless, it wasn't any stress. That said, when I see that, I say, wow, my Father can bless at this level. And I said, thank you, Lord, for showing me what you can do. And I know that if I continue to serve you faithfully, if that's my destiny, if that's my call, if that's my grace, I will enter into such things effortlessly too. And everything that has happened in my life so far has been that way. I don't like unnecessary stress. You know, people go out in faith doing things. That's not faith to me. Faith is, as God leads me or reveals to me, then I act on what he has revealed. And then he funds it. That's faith. Not for me to decide. That's presumption to me. And I see all kinds of stress, all kinds of pressure. No, beloved, may God give us wisdom to follow him in Jesus' name. And so we're reading about this young man. He has joined himself to a man of the land where he was, and they sent him to the field to feed swine, and said he came to himself. May God let all of us come to our senses, come back to ourselves. He says, I will arise and go to my father, and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. You see, he planned his repentance speech. I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of the hired servants. He prepared himself. I'm going back home. Don't let shame keep you from going back home. I remember once I was out ministering at the homeless shelter, and this man came to me just weeping. We had a cookout outdoors, and we're just ministering. He came to me and said, listen, can you pray for me? I said, what is it? He told me how he had a flourishing ministry. He had grown to 500 members, and then he fell into adultery and lost everything, and he just became homeless. He just left town and just hanging around with homeless people, going from shelter to shelter. And I told him, listen, God forgave you long ago, but now he wants to do something greater. He said, what is it? He wants to take you back to the same place where you failed him, and embarrassed yourself. And he wants to restart your ministry to defy Satan and all the naysayers. And when I touched him, the fire of God fell on him and he wept. He said he hadn't felt the anointing in years. I'm telling you, he was gone back to Virginia that weekend. And I believe with all my heart that his ministry is thriving today. Beloved, it doesn't matter how far you've gone. Don't be jealous of the people that kept their own and never sinned and never lost it. Rejoice with them. But come back to your Father. He will mend you. He will fix you. You will go through some things. You will have challenges. You have difficulties. People will remind you. People will torment you. That's all part of it. Take it. And God will honor you and bring you back to your call. In Jesus' name. That's a word for someone. So he arose, verse 20, and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, watch this, his father saw him He was a great way off. His father saw him, meaning the father knew that every step he took away from him would end in disaster. And he was expecting him to come back so that he saw the young man way before the young man saw him. Beloved, what is he telling us? Your heavenly father has been watching over you, even in your days of sin, even in your days of rebellion. And he's waiting on you to start taking that step. He will hear your heart. He knows what's in your heart. And he wants to give you your whipping and set you back on course. Of course, this young man didn't get a whipping, but he was just showing us, you know, the Father's forgiveness in the story and his mercy. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran. Can you believe that? And fell on his neck and kissed him. Wow. He ran, fell on his neck and kissed him. What forgiveness, what compassion, what grace our Heavenly Father has toward us. Because sometimes when I see some of the errors I make, I just want to slap myself. You know, some people can't, you know, don't even have the grace to see their own errors. They always see only what other people do wrong. Then may God grant you grace. Open your eyes so you can see. In Jesus' name. Fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, the father didn't even respond. But look at his heart. I want you to see something, because we lose that in the rendering of this story. The father was responding to his heart. It was his heart that caused the father to run. It was his heart that caused the father to embrace him. It was his heart that caused the father not to even mention what he had done. May your heart be so broken before God that he will overlook your errors. He didn't even respond to the young man's plea for forgiveness. He didn't even talk about anything. Instead, he started giving instructions to bless the young man. Started giving instruction how to restore him. Yes, you squandered your inheritance. You may not get it back. But I'm restoring you as my son. I'm restoring you. Take the restoration first. Don't worry about what you lost. Get back where you can hear from God again. And where you can fellowship with him. Where he can bless you, impact your heart, and change you. Come on, you never know what he will do for you. Give him the room. Don't name your price. No. That's how you lose. Just let him bless you as he sees fit. That's how I live my life. I don't go making demands, reminding him of this and that. No, beloved. I just let him bless me, and I've been enjoying the ride. Glory to God. Every year has been greater than the year before. It's true for my life personally, and it's true for Resurrection House for All Nations. We love you. We give God the praise. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.